Councillor Wesley Murray?
Present.
Councillor Nambrosino?
Here.
Councillor Lakeman?
Here.
Councillor Woolsey?
Here.
Councillor Hughes?
Here.
Councillor Santino?
Here.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Here.
Receiver of taxes, Donald Westley.
Here.
Please call the first public hearing.
Proposed local law regarding regulations and restrictions to limit parking in Oceanside and Seaford.
Does anybody wish to be heard? Does anybody wish to be heard in this matter? May I have a motion?
Mr. President, I move the public hearing be closed and the act adopted.
Second motion.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councillor Nambrosino?
Aye.
Councillor Lakeman?
Aye.
Councillor Woolsey?
Aye.
Councillor Hughes?
Aye.
Councillor Santino?
Aye.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Aye.
Please call the next public hearing.
Proposed local law regarding parking restraining prohibitions in Oceanside, Seaford and Rooneydale.
Does anybody wish to be heard in this matter? May I have a motion?
I move that the public hearing be closed and the comments be made in the next section.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councillor Nambrosino?
Aye.
Councillor Lakeman?
Aye.
Councillor Woolsey?
Aye.
Councillor Hughes?
Aye.
Councillor Santino?
Aye.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Aye.
Please call the next public hearing. Proposed local law regarding not taking stops in Inwood and Wantagh. Does anybody wish to be heard? May I have a motion?
I move that the public hearing be closed and the item adopted.
Second motion.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councillor Nambrosino?
Aye.
Councillor Lakeman?
Aye.
Councillor Woolsey?
Aye.
Councillor Hughes?
Aye.
Councillor Santino?
Aye.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Please call the next public hearing.
Proposed local law regarding school speed limits in Roseville.
Does anybody wish to be heard? May I have a motion?
I move that the public hearing be closed and the public hearing be adopted.
Second.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councillor Nambrosino?
Aye.
Councillor Lakeman?
Aye.
Councillor Woolsey?
Aye.
Councillor Hughes?
Aye.
Councillor Santino?
Aye.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Aye.
Please call the next public hearing.
Proposed increase and improvement of the town of Hempstead street lighting district.
Does anybody wish to be heard? May I have a motion?
Supervisor, I move that the public hearing be closed and the proposed increase and improvement of town Hempstead street lighting district be approved.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councillor Nambrosino? Councillor Lakeman?
Aye.
Councillor Woolsey?
Aye.
Councillor Hughes?
Aye.
Councillor Santino?
Aye.
Councillor Keith Sweeney?
Aye.
Please call the next public hearing.
Application of 6-10 Nassau Realty Corp. for special acceptance public garage to be used as auto body repair shop with permission to for temporary storage of vehicles under repair in Kingwood.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Madam Supervisor, members of the board, Christian Brown, Song Board, and Kashinana, PLLC, 333 year old Liberty Boulevard, Suite 601 Uniondale, appearing for the applicant.
Michael Hinman, 9 Patio Court, Monroe, New Jersey, 0831.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. We're here before you today on an application for a public garage in Inwood. Subject location is known as 6-10 Nassau Avenue in Inwood, at section 40, block 1-4, lots 22 through 29. On the Nassau County Land Tax Map, it's located on the northeast corner of Nassau Avenue and Craft Avenue in the industrial zone. Again, that's in Inwood. And again, we are seeking a special exception from the board this morning in order to maintain an existing auto body shop, also with permission to store vehicles under repair outside. And that's pursuant to this board's powers under the Building Zone Ordinance Section 220, which governs permitted uses in the industrial zone and gives this board, as you know, the power to grant this type of public garage use as a special permit. This is a one-story structure. It was built under permit 13345 in 1953. There's no other permits or certificate of occupancy on file, so it is the building has functioned for about 60 years just under that permit. It's previously been used for various industrial type uses. It was a factory at one point, we believe, and I believe prior to Five Towns Auto Body, which is the tenant of the premises that is operating the auto body shop. It was a sort of a shipping warehouse. It's a large open space, about 8,500 square feet, and the shipping use generated a fair amount of truck traffic. That use has now moved to another part of Inwood. As you know, Inwood has quite a few cargo type uses given its proximity to the airport. As I mentioned, this is an auto body shop now. It's been operating since approximately October of last year. All work is done inside the premises. It is, again, is a large open space in the nature of a large garage or warehouse. There is a spray booth. That spray booth is fully enclosed and inside the subject premises. There's a small office on site with a small waiting area. On average, they service about 4 to 5 vehicles a day. There are 6 employees on site. 2 of those employees are administrative. They work in the offices, and then there are 4 mechanics working in the garage. There are 10 parking spaces proposed, all on site. You can see that on your site plan. One of those will be a handicapped spot. The parking lot is existing, although not striped, and it will be striped should this board grant this application and we move forward back in the building department to obtain a certificate of occupancy. They will probably also have to obtain a parking variance from the Zoning Board of Appeals, given that there was no CFO ever issued on that building. But again, as you know, after this board passes on the application, hopefully it approves it, it'll be back into the building department for a further analysis. The 10 parking spaces for the customers are very lightly used. The employees park on the street. In a moment, I'll hand up some photographs so you can see that there is an ample on-street parking in this industrial area. About 80% of the work of this shop is produced by local auto dealerships. They're only about 20% is customers coming to the site for private service. All the services pick up, drop off, so there's not a tremendous need for parking. I know this board has heard many of these cases. I did one just about a year ago that the board approved a similar situation for muffler repair and truck repair just one block to the north on Bayview Avenue. And again, it was a similar situation where all the customers came and picked up and dropped off. There was very little need for on-site parking. The same situation obtains here. As I mentioned, 80% of their work is service for dealerships, including Rockaway, Nissan Chrysler, and Glencoe Volvo. So generally what happens is either some of the guys from Five Towns Auto Body will go to these sites and then actually drive the car back, or the dealerships will drop off the cars directly on site and, of course, leave thereafter, and then the cars will return to the dealerships. There are no trucks involved here. There's no truck repair. The cars are not coming on flatbeds or those large car carriers. It's really a one or two at a time situation where one guy drives the car, the other guy follows him, then returns to the dealership. So, as I said, this auto body shop is doing most of its work for dealers, and there's very little traffic generated as a result of the use. It operates from 8:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday to Friday. It is not open on the weekends. Just a bit about the area character. As I noted, the subject premises is in the industrial zone. There are really no residents anywhere nearby. You have to go to the very outer edge of the 300-foot radius. It's actually beyond the notification radius that this board requires, all the way up to Rockford Avenue to the north, even to touch on any residences. It is surrounded by manufacturing and other similar type uses. Abutting it to the east on Nassau Avenue is a large ambulance storage yard. The next lot to the east on the corner of Sheridan Boulevard is a gas station and car wash. Across Nassau Avenue, on the south side of Nassau Avenue, is also zoned industrial and business zone on the corner of Sheridan. There's actually another auto body shop on Sheridan Boulevard within the 200-foot radius, just one off the corner, the southeast corner of Sheridan Boulevard and Nassau Avenue. To the rear of the subject premises, where the cars enter and exit, that's where the garage doors are located. That's on the Craft Avenue side. That's also, that happens to be zoned light manufacturing, and there are various manufacturing type uses there. As you can see, I'm proper to you that this is an ideal location for an auto body shop. It is completely isolated from residents. All of the surrounding uses are of an industrial or light manufacturing type character, so it fits in very nicely with the neighborhood. As I mentioned, as a part of the process that we're now going through, there will also be some improvements to our site. Some of those improvements have already been made. There is an inspection report for you. Some of the problems cited in that report have already been addressed, including the removal of barbed wire from the fence, which was a pre-existing. We will be filing for a permit, if we are approved today, to maintain the storage container that is sited there. As I mentioned, the site will be cleaned up. The parking lot will be striped. It will be kept in a neat and orderly fashion. The debris that's referenced in your report was just happened to be there while they were in the process of doing some work on the cars. It was removed immediately. And I believe when the inspector came back, he noted its removal and he noted some of the efforts that have already been made to come into compliance. So what you really will have here is a 60-year-old building that has never had a CFO that sort of operated under the radar, if you will. It will be fully legalized, hopefully with your approval. It'll obtain a CFO with the requisite variances and the requisite site work. Any beautification that this board would require or suggest, we'd be happy to do. I believe the fencing is now in full compliance, as I said, with the removal of the barbed wire. We now have a legal 6-foot fence. And just a final word on the storage of vehicles. Most of the vehicles that are being worked on, as I said, they're only working on 4 to 5 cars a day. If a car is staying there overnight, the majority of them are kept inside this rather large facility. There are times when they have 2 or 3 cars outside, but they are parked in the parking lot. The parking lot is fenced and enclosed, so it doesn't, and it's really set back quite a bit, so they're really not visible, and we're only talking about 2 to 3 cars, and it's not the situation that we sometimes find where cars are parked, say, in front of a set back on a corner, and it looks rather unsightly. This parking lot is on the side, and it has 100 feet of depth, so the cars can be kept in the back towards the storage container, and they are behind fencing. With that, I'd just like to hand up for the board's examination a couple of photos taken by myself. The first 3 show the office area and the interior of the garage itself. The next one shows the other auto body shop located on Sheridan Boulevard that I mentioned. And the final 5 photographs, which I've labeled on the back, just give the board a sense of the conditions in the neighborhood. We have the gas station and car wash on the corner of Sheridan Boulevard. We have a photo looking east along Nassau Avenue up towards Sheridan Boulevard, taken from the front of the subject premises. We have a shot across Nassau Avenue, right across the street from the subject premises. So you'll see there's a large industrial-type yard where contractors' equipment is stored behind fencing. We have a shot looking west, down Nassau Avenue from the subject premises. As you'll see, there are cars lined up all along the street here, and these are the various factory and industrial-type uses in the area. And then one taken on Craft Avenue, right in front of where the garage doors are, where the cars come in and out of our facility. And you can see right across the street on Craft several industrial uses. There's even a little forklift doing some work right across the street. So with that, we would, I hope the board will look favorably on this application. As you know, this is a permitted use in the industrial zone, subject to this board's imposition of any appropriate and reasonable conditions, and with this board's special permission. Again, we feel it's an ideal location of being so far back in an industrial area and away from any residences, and we believe that by legalizing this long existing structure, bringing it into full compliance, the structure will be better used, more aesthetically pleasing, and we will continue to provide jobs and commerce in the Inwood community.
Supervisor?
Yes.
Councilor, looking through the file of the building department, you enumerated some of the problems that were present at this particular property. One is that without a permit, the auto body shop has been operating for over a year. Without a permit, there's been maintenance of outside storage of discarded auto parts. There's the illegal fence. We have pretty concrete information that the applicant's been parking vehicles on the front yard setback, on the sidewalk, that there's been a structure, as you alluded to, that has been on the property that does not have a permit. And I think from our file, it's pretty clear from not only the building department, but from residents and taxpayers in the area that the property hasn't been maintained very well. So I'm going to take what you said under consideration, and I think you're going to need to meet with our building department and talk to them about some of the things that you can do to regain our confidence that you're going to operate legally, that you're going to follow the rules, and that the property is going to maintain in a way that, quite frankly, Supervisor Murray and the whole board now are focused on the revitalization of the Inwood community. So the fact that these things have existed in the past is not a template for what we want to be moving forward. We want to make that community a vital community. We want to beautify that community. We want to make it a better community. So these are things that the applicant needs to take into consideration. So you know what the issues are. So I would appreciate if you meet with the building department to discuss concrete ways that we can address those items.
We certainly will. We've already been in touch with Inspector Rogers. I know he's going to be back to the property, as I mentioned. Some of those problems have been corrected. There will be no more parking on the sidewalk. The problems with the fencing have been removed. Applications will be filed to maintain proper fencing. That shed or large storage container will also be filed for that. We will be working with the building department to come into full compliance. I completely agree with what you said, Councilman. They are a tenant there.
What are the bushes? It doesn't take much to
I agree. I agree. And I think my client would agree that some site improvements do need to be made. They've been operating here since October of last year. I'm not saying it's an excuse, but I would hope we could agree it would be an opportunity to do something better.
Thank you, Councilor. I have no further questions, Supervisors.
Any other questions, Mr. Speaker?
No, thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor, members of the board.
I don't have any speaking slips, but does anybody wish to be heard on this application? If not, may I have a motion?
Yes, Supervisor, I move that the hearing be closed and that the board reserve decision. Second.
Supervisor Murray. Councilman Emerson. Councilman Blakeman.
Aye.
Councilman Lewisby.
Aye.
Councilman Hughes.
Aye.
Councilman Santino.
Aye.
Councilman King Sweeney.
Aye.
Again, thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. May I have a motion?
Supervisor, I move that we call item number 13 on the administrative calendar before we call the decision.
I second the motion. Does anybody wish to be heard on this motion to move and to consider administrative item number 13? If not,
Please call item 13.
I move item number 13.
Resolution adopting a negative declaration and determination of non-significance in accordance with New York State Environmental Quality Review Act process for the application by Nesso Event Center LLC for conceptual master plan approval in Mitchell Field mixed use MFM district.
Madam Town Clerk, my mistake. We should actually vote on moving administrative item 13. So if you could call the roll, I would ask if anybody wished to be heard on the moving of the administrative calendar. No one has raised their hand. Good. Please call the roll.
Supervisor Martin.
Aye.
Councilman Ambrosino.
Aye.
Councilman Bateman.
Aye.
Councilman Goosby.
Aye.
Councilman Hughes.
Aye.
Councilman Santino.
Aye.
Councilman King Sweeney.
Aye.
And now if you would please read administrative item number 13.
Resolution adopting a negative declaration and determination of non-significance in accordance with the New York State Environmental Quality Review Act process for the application by Nesso Event Center LLC for conceptual master plan approval in the Mitchell Field Mixed Use MFM district.
Does anybody wish to be heard on the substance of administrative item number 13? Ms. Merrick? Good morning.
Good morning. Meeting Jim Merritt at 758 Wesley Street, Baldwin. Thank you, Supervisor Murray, for clarifying that, because I didn't have a question about the movement. I did have a question about the resolution. I would like to get some clarification with regard to what that actually means and the impact in terms of the residents overall with regard to this process, because it is massive.
You're talking about administrative item number 13.
Yes.
Basically, what that a negative declaration means that the board has determined after an environmental analysis, the CEQA analysis, that there will not be a negative impact on the environment by the proposed development.
So no negative impact in terms of the water quality, sewage, things of that nature.
Exactly. That's the results of the CEQA analysis.
And what was the, I guess, what was the methodology used for this? I'd be curious to know.
Supervisor, we had a public hearing last week on the CEQA, on the environmental application for the CEQA NCDEC. We had that hearing last week, and we had studies done on the entire project.
Yes, I was here for that, so I'm still concerned.
That book is about that thick, and that's what was before the board last week at the public hearing.
Okay.
So all the environmental studies had been done.
So everything is, there's going to be no issues that are going to come up later for residents and the weeded gnome, all of those aspects of physical and environmental challenges to.
All of the developer studies together with the environmental studies done by the panelists that show that there'll be no adverse impact on the environment.
Okay. I just needed to have that clarification and to make sure that was on the record. Thank you.
Yes.
Felix Picacci, 1165 Bond Street, Franklin Square. And just one question. At the last meeting, the master plan, the way I remember it, was not complete. The way it submitted, there were items on there that were left open. So I'm just curious, in the general sense, how did they deal with the environmental studies on items that were not concrete? I mean, if you submit a plan and part of the plan is determined and then part of it is up in the air, how do you deal with that?
But they weren't on the basic the environmental aspects that would have been part of the environmental review. They were more towards specific aspects of building, some green building, and there will be some conditions as part of a decision-making process. So as I recall, it was specifically about green provisions in the building materials. Mr. Ratner's group had mentioned on the record last week was that they had requested that those green aspects of the building, instead of being part of the decision-making process here, they'd be made part of the site plan approval. That was my recollection from the developers. So it wasn't that they were looking for a total relief from it, but it was simply a review of the building materials, the green aspects of the building, to be determined at the site plan approval.
Correct, Supervisor. It's a conceptual master plan. It's a sequencing deck on the conceptual master plan. We know how much square footage is going to be developed. So that's why the environmental people, Supervisor, right here, but you're correct in exactly what you said. This is on the conceptual master plan.
Okay, so then it's no, like, making a green building, I guess, is different from making regular buildings, and the architecture of that is determined that will not have a negative impact on the environment, sewage, or anything else.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly, because the structure, the size of the building, that's part of, that has been part of the process, but it's about, you know, this particular material or that material. That's what will be discussed at the site plan approval process.
What I was thinking when we talk about the environmental issues, if you're going to build a house that's, you know, powered by solar and wind and stuff like that, the construction of the actual house may be a different configuration than it would be if I decided I'm going to heat it with natural gas, you know, for example. And I think the construction may have an environment, but the way you construct the building may take more floor space or something like that, or have to be constructed in a different way that could have an environmental impact. You know, that's what I was just talking
about. But the floor area ratio, the density, the heights of the building, those were contemplated in the master conceptual plan.
Okay.
And so, you know, that's part of it. Yeah.
Okay.
Is anybody else wish to be heard?
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councilman Anderson?
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman?
Aye.
Councilman Brewster?
Aye.
Councilman Hughes?
Aye.
Councilman Santino?
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley?
Aye.
Please call the decision calendar.
Application for conceptual master plan approval for the Mitchell Field Mixed Use MFM District and to dispense in part the conformity with certain provisions of the MFM district and to make certain findings in connection with a proposal to construct improvements in the MFM district.
I move that the application be granted subject to the conditions listed in the resolution, which were filed this morning in the office of the town clerk, approving the applicant's petition for a conceptual master plan approval, dispensing in part with conformity with certain provisions of the MFM district and making certain findings affecting the real property involved.
I second the motion. Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councilman Anderson?
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman?
Aye.
Councilman Boosby?
Aye.
Councilman Hughes?
Aye.
Councilman Santino?
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley?
Aye.
Please call the next decision.
Application for Black Acres 611 LLC for variance from provisions of GSS ordinance to construct a 3,350 square foot convenience store and a new gas station with 6 pumps fueling aisles with a new canopy, 12 parking stalls, and related site work.
I have a motion. Move that the request in the application be granted.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councilman Anderson?
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman?
Aye.
Councilman Hughes?
Aye.
Councilman Santino?
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley?
Aye.
Please
vote on the
decision.
Application for East Meadow Properties LLC to rezone from Residence B District to Resident CH District and permission to park in the front yard center. Back. Please, Meadow.
Did you call Councilman?
Councilman, you were absent at the time of the hearing?
Okay, where are we? May I have a motion?
I move that the application be approved.
Second motion.
Supervisor Murray?
Aye.
Councilman Abrasino?
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman?
Aye.
Councilman Brewster?
Aye.
Councilman Hughes?
Aye.
Councilman Santino?
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley?
Aye.
Okay, please call the administrative calendar with the exception of administrative item number 13, which was already considered and voted upon.
We have items 1 through 63, with the exception of item 13.
Is anybody able to set up any items?
Yes, Supervisor, I move the administrative calendar in its entirety with the exception of item number 13, which has already been acted upon.
Supervisor Murray?
And you have some rules to be heard. And Mr. Pataki?
Item number 10. I noticed you had the bids for the job, and they varied a lot. And I remember in the last hearing we had an issue where we withdrew the bids and everything because of the wide difference. Here you have 1.45 million, 2.38 million, and 2.71 million. It's quite a big difference percentage-wise, between each of these bids. You pick the lowest bid, which I'm all for, but it was just the question of really the difference in the bids. This didn't raise any red flags as to the quality of the contract that went out, the proposal that went out for bid, based on the fact you have in one case 1.45 to 2.71 is maybe 85-90% difference in price. One in the middle is somewhere in the middle. Yeah.
I think our controller can speak to that. There
were five bids that came in, the highest bid. I should say the lowest bid was 1.4 million. The second bid was $800,000 higher. So that precipitated us to call in the lowest bidder and said, look, we need to demonstrate to us that we can make this happen. The time frame being an 18-month period to put up the cost of $50,000 change out of LED lights. We also need to have a comfort level that we're paying for that rent. And so Bill, they did demonstrate that. That's been memorialized in the letter that I put in the file. We're satisfied based upon the presentation that they can in fact do this timely and have the budget amount of paying for that.
And that was impossible at the last hearing where we recall the bids and look at the lowest bidder and ask them to demonstrate that they could perform on the low at that time.
I think Commissioner Hopkinsey said as a result of conversations that I don't want to mischaracterize the commissioner's conversation, but I think the other bidders actually said they misunderstood. Well, why do I look for it? Commissioner Robbins, why don't you?
It was a different situation. In our case, Robbins, we were unsatisfied that our specifications, both in our plans, identified the item correctly, and we were going to use it for, so we wanted to make changes to the spec to the plans.
Okay. Then next question has to do with, I guess, virtually the remaining old bond resolutions. I calculated about $16 million with borrowing. Still, when I checked this morning with Moody's and Standard Poor's, it still shows that we've borrowed no additional money since January 2014. although we passed, you know, tens of millions of dollars of bond resolutions for that purpose, I did FOIA recently, I didn't get the results yet, the CUSIP numbers involved with the bonds that were passed. Are we planning, I mean, the interest rates are really low now, do we plan on actually implementing these resolutions this year? You know, interest rates are at rock bottom, I'm not sure what, you know, we wait for a lower level, but, you know, it's just a question of why we keep passing resolutions for these bonds, and it doesn't seem, at least from the information I get, maybe I'm getting bad information, that we're actually borrowing this money.
We got this conversation back.
Yeah.
What we're doing here today is authorizing the 2015 capital plan as it relates to infrastructure needs in the county. We go into the market and we need the money. It's based on timing of implementing the capital, spending money, and getting into the market. Of course, we don't want to go in today, knowing full well we're not going to draw that money down for a number of months in terms of that service.
Sure, this is
the timing issue is also
okay. In particular, number 14, I wish the resolution were put more clear on the website so then, you know, it would say time here so I could just read it and it would be clear. It's $270,000 of upgrades to the animal shelter. What exactly do we plan on doing with that money?
There are five issues here. One is a dog run academy for $100,000, consulting fees for $30,000, academy and fencing for $50,000, office trailer electric for $50,000, storefront encasement for $40,000, only projected $207,000.
What's the office trailer for?
Additional office space.
So you have a shortage of space. Okay. Number 15 is $25,000 for renovation of the pavilion. I see that we did do a lot of renovation. Is that paid for with a bond referendum also? And what are we planning on doing with this $25,000?
This is the town hall pavilion. This is an HVAC upgrade for $25,000.
Okay. The air conditioning seems to be working very well today. On the issue of it's item number 39, the reason why I asked about this one, you know, I don't really know anything about it, is I see a lot of public safety vehicles parked overnight around the town. And are employees allowed to take their vehicles home and use them as transportation to and from work?
Supervisor, these are public safety vehicles. These are patrol vehicles. These are furniture. Four vehicles for $265,000.
Well, yeah, the vehicles that have the big blue letters "public safety" on the side. I see them parked overnight in people's houses, you know, at nighttime. You know, and I just was wondering if that they gain a benefit, you know, having a vehicle to transport themselves to and from work. You know.
None of the patrol vehicles are assigned to anyone overnight. The possibility of them being there on their lunch period could be.
So the patrol vehicles that are left here at the end of the person's shift?
Yes.
The public safety officer's shift.
Just so we're talking about the same thing, we're talking about the vehicles that have the big blue letters, that's the patrol vehicles. Those are the vehicles I see parked 6, 7 o'clock at night, you know.
Those 24-hour operations?
Yeah, they're parked in front of someone's house, you know, off, nobody there, you know. And I just was wondering if that's, you know, the benefit that the employees receive to drive the vehicles home.
Okay.
Items 49 and 50 essentially the question is what are they going to be used for? I really don't understand the programs.
So for item number 49 is traffic control, and it deals with the problem of transportation compliance issue as it relates to the reflectivity program. And the total capital cost here is $200,000.
What's reflected?
The signage, the font of the sign, which is, they did increase the font size, but the stop sign was reduced.
And next one? And the next one, 50, the geographical information system, the traffic signs?
Yes, there's traffic control, public general services, geographic information system. Basically, this is the database for where all the signs are. It's an information system.
And I just need to mention this again. It's the same thing, item 56, has nothing to do with money, I guess it doesn't directly, but I looked on the website again, we're still not advertising the non-tested positions. I don't understand why. I don't understand why we differentiate between tested positions and non-tested positions as far as residency requirements. I think it's unfair. I mean, we've had a councilman here who's brought up to private contractors, private developers, about hiring within the town. We break out, I don't know, that credo at the time. We don't advertise, we don't make the same requirement that all employees should be residents of the town unless they are, there's a category that, you know, requires like commissions and things like that, where it's a special, it's hard to get, you know, the right people, you know, limited geography. Why can't we just advertise basic entry-level position on the town website? I don't understand why we can't do that. It doesn't cost anything, and people will know that these jobs are available. When I spoke with the director of civil service, Robin Schmidt, I asked him, why can't we, on those, all the mailings we get, why can't we put a statement saying that you can go to this webpage and find jobs that are available in your town? You know, by the town government. And he said he was going to speak with Michael Beery about that. And, you know, we got mailers since I spoke with him about that issue. And we don't do anything. And I don't really understand the why behind that. Why can't we do that? It doesn't cost any money. And why can't we be fair to all residents and give them the opportunity to gain employment with the town? I'm talking about non-tested positions. Why can't entry-level clerk labor positions, why can't we advertise those on the town's website? I don't understand that.
Because we're not necessarily, depending on the
opportunities
of the departments, it's not an ongoing need.
I think it's fair for the residents. I think if the residents knew that we're not doing that, I don't think they would be happy about that. I think everyone deserves an opportunity to gain employment for every job, and I think they all should be advertised. Okay, one last item, it's number 62. I see it's just calling for a hearing, but it would be nice if, you know, once again, the law requires this. I'm sure that you didn't call this hearing without some conceptual design of this plan in mind. Why can't we put that per the law on the website so I could look at this law that you're proposing, and understand it's a proposal, see what the requirements are, and, you know, and anyone, not just me, but anyone can look at the website and, you know, see what type of law you're passing.
Bukachi, we scheduled it for June 23rd. It will be posted by the end of the week. It will be posted by Friday. It's still being, there are some typos, it's still being worked on. It will be posted by Friday. There is no legal requirement that it be posted now, but it will be posted by the end of the week.
Well,
the hearing is June 23rd. That's why it's so far out in the future.
Mr. But there is, I mean, if you want to be technical about this, it's the call of the hearing, but many of these hearings, resolutions that you're passing today are not detailed out enough that anyone going to the website could really understand. Many times I have to either foil it, ask questions, and the information should be readily available. I create Word documents here. It would take me all the work I do, literally minutes, to put it out on the website. Minutes.
The hearing is June 23rd.
But all the resolutions should be like that way. It shouldn't be just be when I ask. Thank you very much.
Does anybody else want to hear anything?
morning, Mary Madden, to Fort Ridge, our place is now. The item 14, if you could clarify again, those items.
Total file resolution, $270,000. Total mechanic fee for $100,000. Consulting fee, $30,000. Academy expenses, $50,000. Office trailer electric upgrade, $50,000. Storefront replacement, $40,000. Total, $270,000.
And the office trail, I'm most interested in that. What is the purpose of additional office space?
I believe that is what we're trying to do, additional office.
So is the office trail?
Office trail, with additional office space.
Okay. Could you please tell me who made that request? I mean, there is sufficient, so everyone knows. It's an enormous shelter. There's more than sufficient office space for all of the employees. There are not many more that have been hired. I'm just curious as to why and where this is coming from.
As with all these bond resolutions, it comes from the commissioner of public health.
So this came from the commission?
That request originally came from Cindy Acapella before she left. It was part of the plan. She added the shelter. And there is a new office space.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Any administrative items?
About the same number 14, I believe. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you that well.
Did you say office front?
Well, not office front, storefront.
Storefront in case. My understanding is what you think you were doing.
Is there any plan for a cattery? There was a lot of talk about that when Cindy first came in.
That is actually part of it.
Yay. Yay. Very, very good. Because that walk-in closet they're in right now is so depressing. That's very good to hear. Thank you so much.
Item 43. I think I've changed it up a little bit. Just need some clarification about the acquisition of senior enrichment buses for use. How many buses do we currently have? What was the recommendation in terms of getting additional funding for buses for senior use? And why can't we use one of those buses specifically for veterans? Try to maximize my time.
Deputy Commissioner Goldfarb? How many buses can you have? Are these replacing?
Yes, they're replacing. 20 buses, so the buses are beyond compare.
And how many buses does this conflict?
These are two at 60,000 each. Total bond is 120,000.
So two buses at 60,000. Okay. And that's going to help I didn't hear how many of the buses are totally going to be out of repair. The two that you're replacing, or?
They're replacing, yes.
So that would bring the number of buses back to 20.
To 20, yeah.
For the senior enrichment buses. And so I guess the recommendations, as I believe I heard earlier, the recommendations for these types of things that we're acquiring bonds come from commissioners' recommendation?
Yes,
I'm just baffled why we don't have a commissioner specifically for veteran enrichment so that a recommendation could come from someone other than me, that we had some type of mobile support for our veterans to do more outreach. And also, I do like to give credit where it is due, because once I left the meeting here last week, I did have a meeting with Mr. Gales, who I am quite familiar with. I'm quite familiar with the history with regard to
him being here, and I still have a problem with just 1.5 persons being involved with veteran support, but I will say that I am arranging a meeting for him with one of the veterans whose mother is in her home, but she's fighting Alzheimer's. So I do want to acknowledge that, but there are still thousands of other veterans out there who do not have the access to get here, who do not have an advocate. I can't get to everybody, but it would be wonderful if we could collectively look at dispensing some of these funds. And I believe the previous speaker said there's about $16 million in these bonds that I don't see why we can't pay off a little bit to help our veterans. Next question has to do with...
Do you work through the Nassau County Veterans Agency, which is set up and receive funding?
The two people they have there, their funding has been cut more, so I'm pretty sure Mr. Gales probably makes more than what that agency does. And since they're currently under review, and everybody's been reading the Newsday articles about the contracting issue with the Nassau County, that also has been something that I have been trying to bring to attention, because I would still like to know what is the percentage of minority women and veteran-owned contractors with town. That brings me to my other issue. On the item 27, just need, again, clarification on a $700,000 serial bond for acquisition of a new Oceanside Nature Study building.
At Sandy, there was major devastation at our Oceanside Preserve. Not the walkways throughout the preserve, the nature classroom.
I recall that, but I thought that there had been some federal funding that had been allocated for that. Was I mistaken in that?
I think you're referring to the FEMA, we're seeking FEMA reimbursement.
So it's not really a bond, you're seeking reimbursement.
We're doing both simultaneously.
Right, it wasn't fully covered.
Well, I think that that would also be something that taxpayers would like to know, that the funding that was already allocated for repair for these types of structures is not necessarily going to continue to come from our pockets, that the money had already been designated. So we don't necessarily have to pursue a $700,000 bond. So what's the amount that we were getting?
We're going out to the bond market to repair what Sandy has done.
Okay.
Seeking reimbursement from FEMA.
Okay.
If reimbursement is realized, we'll pick it up as income and we'll offset the debt service on the bond.
Okay.
So in effect, FEMA is paying the debt service on the bond, if in fact we realize money from FEMA.
So we're going after the bond?
Yes, I'm thinking.
Okay. Item number four. I just need some clarification with regard to the professional services. I wasn't clear if this related to one project or multiple projects. Is H2M Architects and Engineering on multiple projects sort of thing? And I'm still questioning the vetting process and the inclusion of minority women and veterans in these projects. Along with providing job opportunities and apprenticeships for a number of our students who live on Long Island who are returning from college and they can't find a job here on Long Island. And we want our young people to stay here and have some opportunities to be a part of rebuilding our communities, but we're just not opening up the opportunities for them to do so.
I believe that was probably two properties. It says two at the West Hempstead Building Department.
Yes,
those are referred to two separate properties. So H2M Architects and Engineers, they have to go in when there is an allegation that a property or a structure is unsafe.
That's
and they make a determination, is that recognition?
Yes.
Okay. So basically, how many projects have they, are they kind of like on call? Do you have a list?
They are the company that the building uses anytime we have a structure that is questionable that we need to...
Okay, so this was never put out for like, when was this put out? Was this put out for a bid? Open bid?
It was an RFP was put out approximately November.
Okay, and what methodology was used for the process?
It was advertised as well, was mailed out to numerous engineering firms.
Okay, so these are engineering firms that you already have a list of?
That are licensed contractors, correct. Licensed engineering firms.
Again, I go back to just having a significant problem in terms of going to the same well, and we're not opening the door for opportunity and outreach for others with regard to these projects.
I certainly understand what you're saying, but you're talking about college kids, and these have to be professional engineering firms.
No, I understand that, but I'm saying that the overall bidding process here, again, if we're not opening the door, if we're not promoting the fact that these companies have these opportunities and that they are incorporating some type of apprenticeship for young people to learn.
But they're advertised.
Okay.
Yes, Supervisor. And, you know, this is the 24 hours. This is an emergency contract. We're going to pull out 20,000 a day. So you need a company that's large enough that has enough engineers that can go to these sites 24 hours a day. This company has 40 engineers on staff.
I understand that, but I'm just saying, in the meantime, we can't continue to say, well, you know, they're here, they're available, and they can do it. Because in essence, if we're using any type of government funding, particularly federal funds, we're in violation of the law.
Well, we don't do that. As the commissioner said, we advertise in Newsday, hey, we're going out for professional engineering services. We'll take all takers. What are your bids? What are your proposals?
Yes. That really is kind of baseline outreach, though. As many municipalities are finding out, that you have to, in terms of diversity, you really have to be able to go the second mile. And maybe I'm missing it, but again, as someone said earlier, we get a lot of the publications that have, you know, all of this other information on it. I think if we put out a lot more that really talks about open houses and County Hempstead is open for business for all people, you might be surprised in terms of the other people to find out the things that are going on, because these projects still seem to be geared towards the select few, and we're not opening the door, we're not breaking it open. Just to say you advertise a Newsday is not enough.
I don't think that's a secret newspaper. I think that's
Newsday is not a secret newspaper, but there are also distinguishing factors. We have a community here that is bilingual, so again, there are Spanish language papers, there are Haitian newspapers, again. If we're not diversifying our outreach in terms of announcing this information, just to say, well, we advertised the news that you should have heard about it, that really is not enough. And the onus does become on us, because once the federal lawsuits start to hit, folks can look around and say, I didn't know. Because the opportunities are there, but the people who need to know about it are not getting the information. So sometimes we have to look at what we're not doing beyond the same basic steps. Okay, I think I'm pretty much done. You can rest easy on the bell and the clock. Thank you.
Supervisor Murray.
Aye.
Councilman Nemesino.
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman.
Aye.
Councilman Boosley.
Aye.
Councilman Hughes.
Aye.
Councilman Santino.
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley.
Aye.
May I have a motion?
Second motion.
Supervisor Murray.
Aye.
Councilman Nemesino.
Aye.
Councilman Blakeman.
Aye.
Councilman Boosley.
Aye.
Councilman Hughes.
Aye.
Councilman Santino.
Aye.
Councilman Kingsley.
Aye.
The formal portion of the meeting is over. We have a few citizens. There is for action.
I want to pick up where we left off at the last meeting. You brought up the fact that you held many news conferences regarding abused animals, dog fighting. I did an exhaustive search of the town's website, the town's YouTube channel, and I got all these pages here. You showed screenshots of every YouTube video that's uploaded on the Town of Hempstead website, YouTube channel, I mean. And I have, I downloaded your entire, these are your news in the news on your website. This goes back to 2011. Every time you send out a press release or post something there. This is it. It's right off the website. I just copied and just cleaned it up a little bit to make it look okay, readable. And what I found was there are exactly one dog fighting news release you sent the release out or you put on this website. And that had to do with what happened a week and a half ago with the Bloods gang. There was one other item that had to do with animal abuse that occurred in January of 2011 with the House of Horrors, the mother-daughter, who were torturing animals. And that was a month after a lawsuit was filed by Diane, Lucille, and Francis against you for violating their constitutional rights. I went through, I spent a lot of time looking for data. My search may not be complete, so I submitted a FOIL to the FOIL, and I'll put one on the record for if there are any additional items that I happen to miss in my search. Hopefully, I was able to find what I found going back 6 years, and I would like to see if there's any additional, news press releases where you try to make an effort to bring awareness to animal abuse in the town of Hempstead. What happened just last year was two men, Hector Hernandez and Anthony Reddick, were arrested for dog fighting. In one case, Anthony Reddick, all his dogs died, 13 in the fire in the garage. And the other, Hector Hernandez, his dogs were confiscated. And in the article here from Newsday, it indicated that the animals were brought to an undisclosed location. Also, on NBC News on May 14th, when after the DA announced the Blood gang arrest, they announced that the DA said the animals were brought to an undisclosed location for evaluation. I know everybody coming from the town of Hempstead, Michael Theory, Joe Raj, and yourself are saying that everybody knew. The fact is the DA has policies about handling criminal evidence in animal cases and violate them. I submitted the ethics complaint last week, and I hope that it gets taken very seriously because this is a serious thing. I know everybody likes to turn it into politics, but I don't think you could even see any politics in this. This is a very clear-cut case. The DA has had this policy has had this policy for years, irrelevant of who is in office, that you don't mishandle evidence in the case. And I do hope that you don't repeat this. You do have a judgment in your name. That's one thing that hasn't come up, for violating a person's constitutional rights. You are running for DA, which is a very important position. I don't consider it a political position, and it shouldn't be treated as a political position. It's a very serious position. And the honesty and credibility of the person who holds that office is the most important thing, not whether they practice law. I don't subscribe to that, if people say that. The most important thing of any elected official is their honest and their integrity, because I believe as long as they're curious and willing to learn, any person can do the job. They have enough smarts to figure things out. But those are the qualities I look for in elected officials and leaders of corporation or government. Thank you very much.
I also wanted to follow up with the same situation regarding those animals seized from a drug ring and dog fighting situation. And I wanted to know, the one thing I failed to mention was that Michael Pastore has been a part of the monthly meetings where he has sent a representative at the animal park unit with the DA. And the purpose of those meetings are to educate and train municipalities and their staff on the handling of criminal evidence and the handling of dogs that have been abused coming from these fighting rings. So no one should have known more than Michael Pastore that these dogs should have been, as Cheryl Petrie noted, outside of the public viewing. I'd like to submit this complaint as well, and I'll read it into the record. I am writing this letter to report ethics violations by Hempstead Town Animal Shelter Director Michael Pastore. On May 15, 2015, and on the front outside area of the Hempstead Shelter, Mr. per story, allowed Supervisor Murray to remove and publicly display pit bull dogs seized in an alleged drug and dog fighting bust. Mr. Pastore allowed the dogs to be photographed and appear before the news cameras, revealing their location and jeopardizing public safety as well as criminal evidence. Mr. Pastore's actions violated the shelter's own policies in handling animals safely seized in criminal cases and violated standard procedure instructions from the District Attorney's Animal Crimes Unit, who protects the animals as well as criminal evidence. Mr. Pastore, by allowing Supervisor Murray to mishandle evidence in a criminal case, put the shelter staff at risk and the animals at risk of retribution from the gang from which these dogs were seized. Mr. Pastore's actions clearly show his lack of good judgment and a willingness to break town rules to allow the town supervisor to use these dogs as props for a political campaign. Hempstead Ethics Boards, due to the serious nature of Mr. Pastore's ethical violation, is under obligation to take strong action against the shelter director to discourage any further lapses in his mindless judgment. Diane Madden. Who should I hand this to?
First, we disagree with everything that you said, but it is certainly your right as a citizen to file your complaint.
My other concern is that, and you may not have heard about this yet, but there was a volunteer at the Hempstead shelter who was later fired. She was concerned about a dog, Sierra, that was there, who was came in a very adoptable dog, but over time, and after undergoing the negative training by the trainer that is apparently an acting trainer, started to shut down, spin in her cage, lift the walls, jump. These dogs cannot just maintain. And this dog was also cut off from the volunteers because her color code did not allow for her to get out. This is a cross post. This is not my story. This is a cross post. My hope is that the person that wrote this cross post and paid the consequences for writing this cross post will come and speak herself. I'm afraid Sierra won't make it out of the Hempstead shelter alive. Just a few weeks ago, she was a loving, well-behaved, smart, curious, playful, and fun-hearted dog. I took many walks with her. We played, practiced her word recognition, sat by the stream where she cuddled in my lap, and kissed my face while I pet her. I would let her explore the world, which she did loose leash, always responsive to my voice. If I called her or asked her to walk in a different direction, she would always sit and take treats like a lady. She is now locked up, isolated, with more derogatory behavior remarks piling up against her every time she's taken out for the negative reinforcement training, with jerks to her collar and attempts to force her to submit. The people she knows and trusts aren't allowed to take her on walks anymore. Her trainer uses the excuse, it's for safety. Meanwhile, whenever I visit her cage, she is sweet as always. I believe the reasons of all these derogatory marks are being accrued against Sierra is because she is reacting to this negative treatment. Meanwhile, she's an amazingly compliant with love and talk to her sweet voice. But in the end, as long as she is at that shelter, this punishing trainer who is accruing marks against her, leaving her isolated, lonely, and bored in her cage, has the say in determining her fate. Her written profile is going downhill. Meanwhile, any time I'm near her cage, she leans desperately against the fence so I can pet the side of her neck and talk to her. In all my interactions with her, she is still as loving, as sweet as ever. Thank you.
You have a speaking slip?
Thank you. Some community, beautifully done, all housing, you know,
basically have to go to the the house right next to it, so I'm more visiting on his hand and side. He doesn't get enough, but things
they can adjust.